Greetings, all you 99%ers. This is your host, Dr. Jack Rasmus. This is Alternative Visions. Okay, today we want to cover a number of items. We're going to begin with dissecting the latest U.S. jobs report out today. If you have been listening to the show, I think it was a couple of months ago, I dissected the wage data. Maybe we'll bring an update on that too, but I want to talk about the jobs data and this so-called 263,000 jobs created this month, this past month, meaning in April. Okay, but I do want to talk about some other topics before we come back to that. One, of course, will be what's going on with the central banks, with the Fed here. All of Trump's four nominees have crashed and burned to nominees to positions of governor positions in the Fed. All crashed and burned. What does all that mean? What does the latest decision by the Fed to hold pat on either raising or cutting rates mean, given Trump's demand for an immediate 1% rate cut? I want to talk about the so-called crashed and burned again a second time infrastructure spending bill and the meetings between the Democrats and Trump on that, another dead on arrival. Argentina and Turkey and emerging markets are in trouble once again. And of course, we know the coup in Venezuela, at least the first stage of it, did not come off this past week. What's next there? And then I want to weigh in on a non-economic topic, and that's the Mueller report, or we might say the Mueller-Barr Rosenstein affair. Need to say a few things about that because it's another example of how we are slouching towards a constitutional crisis in this country, step by step. But we'll save that for last. All right, so let's talk about the jobs report. There are problems with the way the U.S. collects and reports jobs data. Doesn't mean that they're outright lying. They don't have to, you see. You can report it in various ways, and you can cherry pick and choose which statistic you want to emphasize. Now, the report that's typically reported and gets the most media news is what's called the U3 employment. Or unemployment, or employment report, the U3 survey. Now, you got to understand there's two surveys that the government uses, and they are oftentimes in conflict with each other. Which one is true? Well, pick and choose. One's called the Current Establishment Survey, or CES for short. The other is called the Current Population Survey, CPS in short. CPS is a survey done by phone of 60,000 random folks, workers out there, or just people out there by the Labor Department. It's a phone survey, which poses certain problems, which we'll get into. The other is the establishment survey, which is kind of like a partial census of roughly 400,000 larger companies. Now, what gets reported is the CES employment numbers that showed 263,000 jobs that the larger enterprises have apparently hired. 263,000, big number, okay? And the CPS survey says that unemployment rate is down to 3.6%. Well, first of all, you got to understand the CPS 3.6% is for full-time employees only. Full-time only. We have about 165 million people in the civilian labor force in this country. About 60, 60 million of those are part-time temp, you know, contingent gig unemployed workers. Okay. So, you know, more than a third now, close to 40%. And rising because the labor markets are changing, and those are the jobs that are being created more and more are part-time temp gig kind of jobs. I'm not saying they're all Uber jobs or TaskRabbit jobs, but those are the jobs that have been created. You got to remember that all these numbers are jobs. They're not employed workers. When the CES says, oh, 263,000 jobs were created, not 263,000 more workers went to work for the first time. Important difference, especially when you have such a large percentage now in the labor markets of part-time temp jobs. People are taking on second and even third jobs more and more to make ends meet, particularly millennials stuck in the service industries. All right. So, once again, keep in mind we're talking about jobs, not workers here. And this one-to-one relationship that used to exist between a job and a worker back in the 70s and 80s and so forth, that no longer exists. That's a big change. And the Labor Department has not adjusted properly for that, I believe. Okay. So, 3.6% unemployment rate for full-time workers. But if you got 65 million people who are part-time, you got to add them to that 3.6% to get what's called a U-6 unemployment rate, not a U-3. U-3 is only full-time. U-6 factors in the part-time and temps that are part-time, so forth, and marginally, in other words, those who are in the labor force but, you know, are in and out of the labor force, haven't looked for a job. You see, you're considered unemployed if you're out of work and you looked for work in the last 4 weeks. That puts you into U3, right? Out of work, look for work in the last 4 weeks. But if you're out of work and you haven't looked in the last 4 weeks, well, then you're not part of the U3 unemployment figure. And it's not a question of whether you're receiving unemployment benefits at all. That has nothing to do with this at all, these calculations. You know, you could have exhausted your unemployment benefits now, which are only 6 months, basically, and still be out of work as an employee. All right. So first clarification here is that, to summarize, the CPS 3.6 is for full-time. That's it, all right? Not the other 65 million people, all right? And the CES, 263,000 jobs created, an employment number, not an unemployment number. See, the CPS gives you the unemployment number, and, you know, we just looked at that. And the CES gives you the employment number of 263,000. Well, wait a minute. You know, if you go back to the CPS and you look at table 8-9 of the population survey, it shows that full-time employment, total full-time jobs, are actually decreasing. February full-time employment in the CPS survey, 130,159,000 in February. In March, 129,969,000. So the actual number of full-time employees in the CPS survey declined 2 months ago by 228,000. And then this latest report today in the CPS survey, the number is down even further, 129,778,000. In other words, another decline last month of full-time jobs, of 191,000 full-time jobs declined. That's the CPS survey. Oh, but they don't report that, do they? They report the CES survey, the large businesses, that show a growth of 263,000 last month. Okay. Now, if you look at that 263,000, however, how many of those jobs, according to CPS, were part-time jobs? 155,000 of the 263,000 were part-time jobs. Well, in other words, the, what is that, 60, two-thirds percent at least, right? 60% or so are part-time jobs that don't show up in the 3.6%, you see, unemployment rate. Okay, what about the previous month, the prior month, between February and March, the March numbers? Well, part-time jobs were 190,000. 190,000, 155,000 last month, 350,000 part-time jobs created in the last couple of months. Well, that doesn't look like it's a booming full-time employment kind of a labor market to me, right? Once again, we have a decline in full-time jobs according to the CPS, and we have an increase of 263,000 in the CES, but 60% of that is part-time. The job creation is coming from part-time workers who are probably adding second and third jobs that isn't being picked up accurately, I believe. Now, another indication support of this is if you look at the April numbers just reported, and we see 112,000 jobs created in government. This is table A-8. 112,000 jobs created in government. Now, this is interesting because this is the first month where we have a creation of jobs in government. In the previous 12 months, from April 2018 through March, we had a decline of government jobs of 375,000. All of a sudden now, we have 112,000 in 1 month created. Well, what is that? Well, I'll tell you what that is. It's the census, the 2020 census. Every 10 years, the government has to do a census, and it starts ramping up employment in April of the preceding year and starts doing the census by the end of the year, okay? I believe 112,000 here, the lion's share, if not all, is hiring for census workers, temporary. Temporary workers being hired by the government to do the census. They hire tens of thousands, maybe hundreds of thousands. I'm not sure the total number they hired in April 2009. Go back to April 2009, you'll see the same phenomenon occur. A big ramp up of government jobs, census workers' jobs here in anticipation of the 2010 census. Same thing is happening here. Same thing. In other words, a lot of these 155,000 part-time jobs created last month are probably these census worker jobs, right? Now, another corroborating piece of information is, if the economy was doing so damn great, why is it that last month 646,000 increase in the category not in the labor force? In other words, people that aren't working, many of whom are dropping out of the labor force in that number, are occurring. And the previous month, 350,000. In other words, a million increase in people not in the labor force. Now, that can't be, you know, more kids being born or more people going to prison or more people going to the military. That would be not in the labor force, right? Couldn't be that. And you couldn't have that many people retiring all at once, right? Those are folks who aren't in the labor force, but that number is growing by 500,000 a month on average the last 2 months. Well, if the economy was so great, why are so many people leaving? Right? Okay. So, in other words, if you look at these different indicators and bring them together, you get a different picture than relying on this phony U3 unemployment rate or this one survey, 263,000 establishment jobs created that don't count the part-timers or don't break out the part-timers there. All right, another problem with the unemployment figures here is that in recent years, prior years rather, in the wake of the recession, Great Recession, we had a lot of folks who went on Social Security disability, SSDI, because unemployment was not as generous, and unemployment discontinues or declines. You don't get it as long. You go on SSDI, you get it as long as you can show you're disabled. So a lot of workers cleverly went on about a million of them went on SSDI. Well, what's happened here under Trump, particularly in the first year, actually began at the end of the Obama administration, was court decisions, administrative law judge decisions that they were going to throw these people back out on the labor force. And that's what they've been doing. Hundreds of thousands of people since Trump came in have been cut off from their SSDI and forced back into the labor force. Maybe some of them are those who are, quote, not in the labor force. They can't really work, so they're staying not in the labor force as they get thrown off of the status. Because you see, if you're on SSDI, you're not in the labor force. That's part of the picture, too. Another problem with the data is that, all this is not really data. All of these figures are what's called statistics, right? What's statistics? A statistic is an operation on raw data. All this unemployment rate and so forth are statistics, estimations. And, of course, a lot of assumptions go into the methodologies of these estimations. Well, here's another problem with the statistic on employment growth. What they do, what the government does, the Labor Department folks do, is they get some raw data and they do a number on jobs and they do a number of statistics operations, adjust for seasonality, adjust for, other factors. One of the other adjustments is called new business formation. New business, the assumption is, every month you got a couple hundred thousand new businesses that are created. Small business. I'm talking about one, two person, three, four, maybe small startups, right? Mostly in the services, consulting and so forth. When you have 200,000 new jobs or new businesses being created. And by the way, you have roughly the same number of new businesses disappearing every month. The net is called new business formation. Now, it's interesting that the government makes an assumption of how many people are employed on average for a new business being created, a net new business. But where it comes into employment numbers is that they take the raw data on new business formation 9 months ago, and they add it to the raw data here for this month of their surveys that they get, the CES, CPS. They add 9 months ago, they add it to the numbers, and then they do their statistical operations on the integrated numbers. Well, 9 months ago, the economy was quite different. Third quarter of last year was kind of strong, right? So they're rolling in those numbers of 9 months ago into the numbers they're reporting now. This is just one example of all the data leisure domain, statistical leisure domain that goes on with these government numbers. It's not lying outright, blatant, but you can see how you can play all kind of games with the numbers, and then you report it falsely. The media falsely reports it, I believe. There's a lot of problems there because they don't really understand the assumptions and the methodologies that go into all this, and don't understand the conflicts between the numbers. And they just report, what they think is the good stuff. 3.6 unemployment, forget it. Worthless statistic. Worthless. 263,000 jobs, okay. But 155,000 of those are part-time temp jobs. And probably the core of that is the census hiring 112,000 jobs. Even if it's not the core of it, you got part-time temp jobs being created. People on SSDI being thrown here into the labor market, into jobs. This phony new business formation assumption that's going on. A million people increase in not in the labor force. That can't be from simple demographics. It has to be people leaving because they can't find work. It creates a picture here, that's a little bit more balanced, I think. And you don't have a booming labor market, folks, period. That's my conclusion. And, I did the latest, but a similar thing last week when we looked at GDP numbers. Remember that? Go back and listen to the show last week. This 3.2 increase in GDP, right? As I pointed out, when you dig down in, you see that the two most important sectors of the economy, household consumption, only grew 1.2%. Business investment, when 1.2%, it's like 70% of the economy, consumption, and business, another 10% of the economy growing only 2.7%. Well, 75% of the economy or more, kind of flat and stagnant. So where the hell is the 2.2% GDP coming from? Well, as I argued last week, if you dig down in numbers, you can see it's all business inventory accumulation and net exports. In other words, both of these are due to the trade war, which is probably coming to an end here when they sign an agreement here with China, before mid-year. That's almost happening. We'll talk about that. When that goes away, inventories are going to decline. Well, why did inventories go up? Well, they went up because in anticipation of the trade war and new tariffs, businesses were stocking up on their inventories, right? Anticipation of, the effects of the trade war were reducing U.S. imports. And the way they do GDP is you can have a growth in what's called net exports, in other words, net trade effect, simply because you're buying less imports, which is happening because of the tariffs. In other words, it's not the U.S. economy growing. It's just this definitional thing about not buying as much imports, which boosts GDP. It's not that we're selling more exports. It's that we're not buying as much imports. These are some technicalities about how they define GDP. Well, that was the analysis last week. When you dig down into these numbers, you see it's mostly trade effects here that are probably coming to an end, and that the real fundamental core of the economy, investment in plant and equipment in the U.S., which is going down, in structures which are going down, and consumer spending, which is 1.2% last month, does not show that the core of the U.S. economy is all that strong, especially as the global economy is getting weaker and weaker. Europe is a basket case. Increasing problems in emerging markets, major emerging market economies. Yes, China has stimulated once again, but these stimulus programs in China don't last very long. In fact, every time they stimulate it, it lasts a little less. That's what's going on over in China. You can see it's slowing in China. Around the corner as well. And the U.S. Is beginning to reflect the slowdown globally. So global forces are pointing towards a slowdown in U.S. GDP, economic growth, and end of the trade war will point to that as well. Now, there may be a trade war boost if they come to an agreement with China, but that will be temporary as well. The federal government will probably continue to increase its defense war spending, which also went up last quarter, 5.1%. So it was the trade effect in defense spending that gives you the 3.2% GDP number. In other words, if you look below and at everything, you know, the full picture, you get a different total picture here on GDP. The same thing with the jobs number. Look below and look at, understand the assumptions in these job numbers and the contradictions in these job numbers that don't get reported, and you don't get this Pollyanna 3.6% unemployment rate, right, and 263,000 jobs. Look at the total labor market, and what comes out is a total different picture. And once again, just to reiterate, the show I had a couple months ago, I forget what date that was, on are wages really growing? No. The 3.2% wage increase last month. That's not wages, that's weekly earnings. Weekly earnings. In other words, your hours worked times your hourly wage, or, you know, your salary. That's a salary number as well. The problem with wages, this 3.2%, is that they are averages, and also for full-time workers only. Averages of folks on salary, in other words, highly paid professionals and managers and so forth, right? And their bonuses and their lump sum payments and so forth. That's all in this 3.2%. But it's an average. And if the folks at the top, the salaried folks at the top of the wage structure, as we call it, are getting significant increases in their salaries and bonuses, bankers, right, so forth, right, it pulls up the average. People at the median or below won't be getting the 3.2% in wage increase because, especially if they're part-time temp, they're not even in that 3.2% calculation once again. So what you get is a stagnation at the median and declines below that, except maybe the minimum wage folks in certain states, they get a boost in minimum wage, so that offsets that in a positive direction. But it's not all states at all times in the minimum wage. But, you know, the big effect is full-time averages, not just wages, but hours of work, and salaried folks, and all their fringe benefits. I don't mean pension benefits. I mean, you know, lump sum payments and bonuses and so forth, right? So it gets skewed to the very top. Look, another independent study on wages indicated, for example, that over half of the workers surveyed said they got no wage increase at all. Well, how can you have such a, you know, 3.2% growth in wages when half of the people don't get it at all? Well, what that means is that people at the top are getting more than 3.2%, pulling up the average, right? And, of course, you're excluding part-time temp, the 60 million people. And then there's another problem with wages, is that these are, quote, real wages adjusted for inflation. Well, if you're underestimate your inflation, you're overestimating your real wage. And I believe inflation is higher than being reported for various reasons. Technical, again, assumptions I'm not going to get into. I talked about a couple months ago. Right? And, of course, they're not including what I call the social wage. In other words, whatever you get in turn when you retire and pensions and Social Security. If that is going down, if people are losing their pensions, getting half of what they're supposed to get, and 401ks and IRAs aren't producing much interest, well then, what do you got? You got a social wage that's not growing, and they don't include the social wage, pensions, Social Security at all. in this wage number. So once again, when you dissect the wages, you see it's people at the top getting more than their share. We're talking about full time, and we're talking about averages here. Well, you know, there's similarities between that game being played on wages to show a growth and similarities on the job numbers. I mean, once again, as I said, 263,000 jobs, unemployment rate, the U3 unemployment is full-time only. So, and when you look at one survey, you got a decline in full-time employment by hundreds of thousands every month, the last couple of months. And at the same time, you have an increase in part-time jobs of hundreds of thousands each month. Okay. A lot of numbers there, right? Maybe some concepts that, some of you listening have not heard before, sound very strange and so forth, but I've been dissecting Labor Department numbers. I started out as a labor economist for quite some time. And, you do it a disservice if you just repeat and regurgitate these numbers that they want you to push out there, like the U3 unemployment rate and the CES 263,000. Right. You're doing a disservice. You're creating a misrepresentation of reality. You're not being totally honest. And even on among liberals and progressives, they just pick up these numbers and they throw them out there and mislead people as to what's actually going on. You got to look at the whole picture. You got to look at the assumptions, the definitions. You got to look beneath the surface and look at the whole scenario on jobs or the whole scenario on wages to get an accurate picture of what's actually going on. And bottom line, and I'll finish with this on these numbers, is that wages are not rising as they're saying for everybody. Good jobs are not being created as they're saying for everybody as well. And the unemployment number is much higher than they're reporting, and folks are still leaving the labor force. Okay. All right. So, that's my two cents on the jobs number. Let's go on to some of the other topics here of the global economy. I want to say a few things, and then I want to end up, as I said at the beginning, with my take on the Mueller-Barr affair, as I call it, right? Okay. Infrastructure deal, not going to happen. Trump and Pelosi, Pelosi and Schumer go to the White House and explore, whether there's something that they could agree on. And, of course, all politicians want to look as if they're going to help create jobs. That's what infrastructure spending would be about. I'm talking about the projects, water projects and sewer projects and bridges and roads and things like that. Well, that's what traditionally is called infrastructure, but that's not what Trump sees as infrastructure. I'll tell you what he sees as he sees another tax cut for businesses that build this stuff. That's what he wants to do. He wants to cut taxes. Or the typical deal, the public-private infrastructure development pilots around some places around the country look like this. In Los Angeles, for example, you got builders who partner with the city government, and the city government gives them the old land that the old city buildings were on virtually for free. It just turns the land over to them or sells that land for $1. Well, downtown L.A. land is worth quite a lot, isn't it? Yeah. In exchange, the builders construct a new city hall, new city buildings, the politicians move into the new city buildings, right? And they don't have taxes to pay on the old. Well, if they're public, they don't pay taxes. They don't have mortgages on the old building or anything like that. They get rid of those costs, and they're now cost-free in the new facilities, and they don't pay, but they did pay, didn't they? They gave land worth tens of millions of dollars, maybe billions, to the builders. That's what's called a public-private partnership. That's what Trump understands as infrastructure. That's the model that he wants. And he doesn't want to raise taxes to pay for it. He wants to cut taxes. You know? He wants to make it another tax cut, as if they didn't have enough tax cuts here, builders. Right? So it's not going to happen. Infrastructure is not going to happen in the sense that we think of it. It's all for public consumption here. Okay. Let's turn towards central banks, right? The Federal Reserve met here this past week and is standing pat on not cutting rates. It's already stopped raising rates. We've talked about that. But the Trump team is pushing Powell and the Fed to cut rates. Earlier in the week, Trump demanded, and his echo there, Larry Kudlow, both of them demanded that the Fed immediately cut the federal funds rate to interest rate by 1%, a whopping 1%. Well, you know, what Trump wants is a overheated economy for the election year, right? He wants that stimulus, monetary stimulus. And the Fed pretty much said, no, we're not going to cut by 1%. But they did cut this other rate called the overnight rate, a token amount, right? But it was a signal, you know, that the Fed is, okay, we're thinking about it. We're leaning in that direction, Donald, but we're not going to do it yet, okay? So we got a fight going on. At the same time, Trump's four nominees to assume these positions on the Board of Governors of the Federal Reserve have now all crashed and burned. In other words, dropped out. You know, this latest guy, geez, I forgot his name. Before him, it was Herman Cain. Two economic clowns. I mean, two right-wing ideologues. No technical economics, you know, understanding or background at all. I mean, it was so obvious that these are just ideologues. They either dropped out themselves when the vetting began and the publicity began. They never even made it to a hearing. Well, what this represents, I think, is what you got in the Trump administration now is second raters, third raters, sycophants, and charlatans. No one else really wants to take any position in the Trump administration. So he's turning to these folks, and we can see them now running U.S. foreign policy. The neocons are back. They're running the whole show in terms of foreign policy. Bolton at the lead of this, John Bolton, you know, the guy who gave us Iraq back in 2003, and his partners, Abrams and Miller and so forth. I mean, these are just right-wing ideologues. And boy, are they causing muddying up the road here in U.S. foreign policy. They prevented Trump from, they shut down the deal with North Korea, right, in a very crude, crass way. So there's not going to be any deal with North Korea here. They're behind the invasion being prepared for Venezuela. Of course, this past week, all this attempt to create a coup resulted in the Venezuelan military standing firm in support of Maduro, right? So that coup has failed, right? This guy Guaido, this little puppet picked up by the U.S., who's really just the face, the power there is Lopez. You know, they thought they would get a coup and the military would break. Well, the military didn't break, you know. But that doesn't mean that the neocons, Bolton and friends, are finished there. No, it just means they'll go to even more direct means. You know, they wanted to try this out. And if it doesn't work, well, then it's the next step. Don't think that these people are going to pull out of that. Bolton has got Trump, totally aligned in what he wants, and that's what they're going to do, right? We will see even more aggressive moves by the U.S. It's not over. Right? Okay, so what else in Latin America? You know, while this situation in Venezuela continues to deepen, the two case examples of U.S. policy and success in terms of overturning governments in Latin America, I'm talking about Argentina and Brazil, are in trouble economically again. Big trouble, particularly Argentina, where its peso, its currency, is falling once again. It already last year deteriorated, 30-40%, and it's already dropped another 5-10% I think, the currency. Now, as I've said many times before, currency collapse is a harbinger, an indicator of deeper economic problems, and it's largely driven by rising U.S. currency, the dollar. As the dollar rises, these other currencies decline. And the dollar's been rising in the U.S. They're trying to put a lid on it. Well, it was rising strongly in 2018 because of rising interest rates by the Fed. But now the dollar is also rising because the Fed can't control long-term interest rates. It only can control short-term. And the long-term rates are rising or not falling. I should say they're not rising. They're rising relative to other countries. That's what's the key. Relative to Europe and Japan, let's say, right? The U.S. rates, I'm talking about 30-year Treasury bond rates, could be slightly declining, but they're actually rising faster in relationship to the euro and the yen. That's what's important. Because when that happens, money flows out of Europe and Japan into the higher currency, the dollar, and drives up the value of the dollar. And that's the big battle going on, you see, between the currencies and the central banks. The fact that the U.S. is not raising short-term rates, the Fed, anymore, means that in Europe, they have to lower their short-term rates even further if they want to be competitive on the currency level. Well, they can't lower them any further, very much. Maybe they can, because it's already negative. Government bonds are negative interest rates. In fact, in the last year, the amount of negative interest rate bonds increased by $4 trillion. Dollar equivalent. In other words, more and more bond rates are in negative territory. Now, this is a problem because if rates are negative, banks aren't going to put their money in their central banks and have to pay to put their money in it. What are they going to do with it? They're going to send it, guess where? To the U.S. They're going to lend to the U.S. or wherever there's dollar businesses, they're not going to lend to European businesses. And that's what's going on, you see. And that's what's driving up the dollar in the U.S. The money is flowing out of Europe and Japan into the U.S. because the Fed is not raising rates anymore, which means that to keep the lower differential, the European Central Bank and Bank of England are going to have to lower their rates. So that's in anticipation of that, the money flows out. Okay, so you got to understand these central banks are linked. They all follow the lead of the U.S., whether it's up or down. They may not go in the same direction, but whatever the Fed does, they have to do in turn. It's just another means by which the U.S. economic empire uses various instruments to maintain its hegemony and control and influence over the rest of the global economy. The dollar, of course, is the big weapon, isn't it? Yeah, 85% of all trade, global trade, is done with the dollar. So all these countries need to get dollars if they want to export and import things they don't have themselves. They need to get dollars because dollars the trading currency. Well, that's the essence of financial imperialism, you see, and that's how the U.S. has destroyed the Venezuelan economy by denying it opportunities to get dollars in order to trade, to buy food and medicine and so forth, creating shortages in their own country. Right? That's purposeful. Well, how has the U.S. Done that? Well, sanctions. Sanctions against any country that buys exports from Venezuela, and that includes Venezuelan oil. Venezuela can't sell its oil, and all oil trading is done in dollars, so it can't get dollars because it can't sell its oil. It can't get dollars from the U.S. from its subsidiary Citgo because that's been seized by the United States. It can't get dollars through its central bank because the U.S. has told the Federal Reserve and has told European central banks and so forth, do not give loans or dollars or allow the Venezuelans to sell bonds from their oil company to get dollars. Don't let them get dollars. So sanctions are really designed for a company, for a country, not to be able to get dollars to buy and sell stuff, which wrecks its economy. And you get a shortage of currency in the economy, so they got to increase the supply of their own currency, which exacerbates inflation, drives down the value of their currency, which also makes it difficult because your currency now buys less internationally. So all these techniques, you know, that the financial imperialism in the 21st century are at play here in the U.S., given its dominant currency, given the dominance of its central bank, given the sanctions that it's relying on more and more, you notice, not only sanctions against Venezuela or Iran and so forth, but sanctions even against, quote, allies. The U.S. is threatening sanctions on Germany, for example, to get it to stop buying Russian natural gas because it wants to sell this excess natural gas from the fracking industry in the U.S. to Germany. It wants to force Germany to buy U.S. gas, not the cheaper Russian gas. You know, the Russian gas comes through a pipeline. They're trying to stop the completion of that pipeline in Germany, the U.S. is, and forcing Germany to invest in a liquefied natural gas terminal to accept U.S. natural gas. You see, all this is about money, right? It's all about energy and oil. All the sanctions are about driving up the price of oil and, you know, what's going on in Germany and sanctions. Well, the U.S. Under Trump is playing this sanctions thing to the full hilt here, and, you know, it may be producing some short-term gains, but, boy, they're pissing off the rest of the world, and that's going to have some repercussions down the road longer term. Trump is, you know, upending all these relationships, and who knows, you know, amongst the capitalists globally, and who knows where all that's leading. Just as he's upending the rules of the game domestically. Yes, and that's why we're headed towards a eventual constitutional crisis in this country. That's the direction things are going. We're at the beginning of this, but that's the direction it's going. You can see the two parts of the government, you know, the executive, Trump, versus Congress now, which is just the House, because he's got the Senate in his hip pocket, and he's got the Supreme Court and a lot of the federal courts as well in his hip pocket. That's why he's so bold, right, taking on Congress, right? Well, let's talk about that issue. What about this Mueller thing, right? We got the Mueller report. I've been plodding through this 448 pages. But let's summarize this, you know. What is really this about? You know, well, it's supposed to be about collusion with the Russians, on the one hand, right, and obstruction of justice by Trump to prevent the investigation fully being, you know, fully completed by Mueller, right? Now, Mueller, a special investigator, is working for the Justice Department. And, of course, we know this guy, Barr, who was the hatchet man way back under Ronald Reagan, you know, when we had the Iran gate. He was the hatchet man back then. Well, he was brought in as a hatchet man here to make sure that the Justice Department was in Trump's pocket. And that's, of course, Barr is in Trump's pocket. Okay, so the two issues are collusion and obstruction of justice. And we get the Mueller report, and the Mueller report really identifies collusion and a lot of obstruction of justice. Well, why didn't Mueller then indict, you know, issue an indictment of Trump? I'll tell you why. Because he's going according to the rules of the Justice Department, which says, rules that were just created in recent years here following the Clinton impeachment, right? Justice Department rules say a special prosecutor cannot indict a sitting president. He could not. If he followed Justice Department rules, which he did, he could not indict for collusion or obstruction of justice. What he did was lay out all the emphasis and said, well, here it is, Congress. You know, it's up to you to impeach. I can't indict. I'm following the rules which the Justice Department wrote. Well, wait a minute. Since when do rules developed by an agency take precedence over the U.S. Constitution? Since when are these rules controlling over the right of impeachment? I mean, the government should impeach. Well, it can't even get a copy of the full report, can it? Unredacted. Well, you know, Trump and his boy Barr here are preventing even Congress from seeing the full report. It looked like the Democrats had completely lost this game once again. Trump, in the public opinion-wise, had captured a public opinion by saying no collusion, no obstruction, right? No collusion, no obstruction. And that's what Barr did in his four-page summary memo, you know, playing that game. Well, it turns out that there was a leak now this week of a letter from Mueller to Barr saying, hey, you're misrepresenting everything I'm talking about here. You know, this four-page summary you said is misrepresentation. And you go back to Barr when he came before Congress and previously when he issued his four-page summary, and he said, well, you know, I haven't heard from Mueller about any disagreement with what I'm saying. Well, he did. He got the letter from Mueller. He was sitting there lying through his teeth. Yeah. Well, you know, these politicians lie. You betcha they do all the time. So what we got is perjury on a part of Barr to protect Trump. And the question is, you know, should the Democrats impeach in the House? Should they impeach? Do they have a constitutional obligation to do so? Or are they going to play politics? And are they afraid of Trump and afraid if they impeach him, they may lose some votes? Well, look, you know, Trump's got 35% solid behind him of the populace. You're not going to change those folks. Trump could strangle his grandmother on the White House lawn, and those folks would still vote for him. Still vote for him. So impeachment isn't going to change those folks. But impeachment, you know, may show that the Democrats, you know, have some backbone, and they're going to do their constitutional duty and go after this guy. Yeah, but the Democrat leadership, this is the poorest leadership I've ever seen since the 1970s. You know, in the 70s, at least they stood up. But Pelosi and Schumer, I mean, look, these are weak folks here. They don't want to take a chance, a risk. You know, politics is full of risk. But they don't want to, they want to play it safe. By playing it safe and cautious, you know, they're earning themselves a reputation of wimps. And this has been true throughout the Obama administration. Wimps. While McConnell and others were whacking them on the head, they were trying to be bipartisan. Mm-hmm. And then, of course, McConnell holds up all the nominations offered by Obama, and leaves all these judgeships open and all these positions open on the Supreme Court and on the Federal Reserve. And then when he gets his House of Representatives here in the first 2 years of Trump, right, what does he do? Well, then he fills them rapidly with all these right-wingers. You know, we got a problem, and that's the court system is full of right-wingers now, you know, including the Supreme Court. And Trump knows it, and he's thumbing his nose at the Democrats saying, okay, go ahead. I got a Supreme Court here. Let's see who wins. I got a Senate here. Let's see who wins, you know. And the Democrats are, you know, no backbone, shaking in their boots. I don't think they're going to impeach him. They should constitutionally, you know, show that they have some backbone and bring out all the dirt. You see, because while they say, well, we're going to hold all of these hearings and so forth, well, they can issue all the subpoenas they want, and Trump and his friends can say, we're not coming. And, well, that's obvious now, right? Issue these subpoenas to get at Trump's, shady deals with Deutsche Bank and Russian oligarchs. No, they're not going to show up for that, right? But if you had impeachment, they would have to show up. Impeachment proceedings, subpoenas issued from impeachment proceedings underway carry more weight than just committee subpoenas that exist right now. Trump is changing the rules of the game right under noses, and they're trying to play by the old rules of the game. That's the problem. He's two steps ahead of them, and they haven't figured this out yet. And that if they want to deal with this guy, they have to change the rules as well. There's no other way. You can't extend your hand in bipartisanship and expect this guy to respond in kind. No, he's not that kind of player. Right? The people he put on the Supreme Court are not that kind of player. He's playing hardball. They're still playing softball. Okay, so that's my take on the Mueller. Right now we got rules that are taking precedence over the U.S. Constitution. And what we got is, will Mueller show up? I don't know. Well, he'll show up if they have impeachment. He may not show up if they don't. Will Barr and the others show up to these House investigating committees? No. Will they show up if there's impeachment? They will have to, and the courts would support that. The courts may not support just these committee hearings, because these are just rules too, you see. Okay. We're heading towards a constitutional crisis. We're drifting, you know. I mean, we already have evidence of that previously. And now we got even more. So it's really going to get interesting before the end of the year. All right, that's the show for today. Alternative Visions.